Years later, though, in September 1997, Bob Pritchard of Jodrell Bank told David Percy that there was neither the interest nor possibility of following Apollo 11, as NASA had not supplied them with the pointing data. Later, though, Pritchard changed his initial story and told Percy that they did track Apollo, but only when it was in close proximity to the moon.
Jarrah's insistence that Jodrell Bank or radio hams are not valid verification of Apollo signals because they didn't track the Apollo spacecraft all the way to the moon and back is ridiculous. Think about it for a moment. If Little Red Riding Hood left home one day and later she arrived at Grandma's, then she obviously took some path to get there. Did she take the path through the woods? Probably. But why does it really matter how she got to Grandma's? She got there, didn't she? Jarrah doesn't recognize the fact that once the Apollo spacecraft refired their S-IVB engine to leave parking orbit and begin their journey to the moon, they were fairly well committed. They would need to wait long enough to complete their docking maneuver with the lunar module and switch to low-power transmissions to evade the Soviets before turning around to fire their SPS engine and drop back to orbit the Earth. If the conspiracists are right, and Apollo could not avoid the Van Allen belts, then at that point they would have spent less time in the proton-rich inner Van Allen belt by passing through it than by turning around and falling back to Earth. In this claim, Jarrah says that Pritchard changed his story about tracking Apollo. But pay attention to Pritchard's use of the word track, or tracking, as Jarrah recites the following letter.
These are his exact words. Dear Mr. Percy, the moon probes were observed with a 50-foot radio telescope, which at the frequency used, 2,300 MHz, had a beam width of 5.8 degrees. In round terms, this allowed us to pick up signals from up to about 1,000 miles above the moon's surface, although small corrections had to be made to the pointing as the probes orbited the moon. Voice signals were received from both the orbiting spacecraft and the lunar lander of good quality, but television signals were only picked up from the spacecraft on the surface of the moon. As we were not actively involved in the tracking of these craft, we did not track them after they had left the moon.
We don't know what Percy's actual question to Bob Pritchard was, as we are not shown his original correspondence. All we have is Pritchard's reply as published in Percy's inventive book, Dark Moon. Whatever the question was, Pritchard answered that Jodrell Bank did not track Apollo 11 on their way to or from the moon, because they didn't have the pointing data to steer their 50-footer. But they were able to pick up their signals when the spacecraft got to the moon. Of course, whether Jodrell Bank independently tracked Apollo 11 or not is irrelevant. It's a red herring. Nobody at NASA thought that they would need second or third-party verification of the events that they were living at the time. In fact, if NASA actually went through the effort of lining up a number of independent sources to give testimonials verifying that the events were real, I think that would be even more suspicious. It's a catch-22, really. Regardless of whatever actions NASA took or didn't take, the modern-day conspiracists would eventually twist them to prove the moon landings were a hoax.
So it seems, either Jodrell Bank did not track the Apollo spacecraft at all, as Pritchard initially said, or they did track the craft, but only when it was on or near the moon. Either way, Jodrell Bank evidently did not track the spacecraft all the way to the moon and back, as is claimed by the propagandists.
So Jarrah disproves yet another straw man. I don't know whose propagandist claims Jarrah is referring to here, he doesn't clarify that in his video. But there was no necessity for Jodrell Bank to follow Apollo 11 to the moon and back, since NASA was already doing that. And regardless of how Apollo 11 got there, Jodrell Bank was able to find both the command module after it arrived in lunar orbit, and the lunar module once it descended to the lunar surface. As with the Luna 9 and other Soviet moonshots, they simply trained one of their radio telescopes on the moon and waited for the spacecraft to arrive. Jarrah's claim that they could find Luna 15 with one radio telescope when it got close to the moon and not be able to find Apollo 11 with another radio telescope when it got close to the moon is nothing short of a major contradiction. And Pritchard did not change his story either. When Piercy supposedly asked him to clarify a statement, Pritchard did not say that Jodrell Bank tracked Apollo when it was close to the moon. Those were Jarrah's words. Pritchard simply states that they picked up the signals when the spacecraft was near the moon. In fact, Pritchard says that they were not actively involved in tracking Apollo. Following Piercy's lead, Jarrah also plays with semantics. Without specifying to and from the moon, Jarrah asked Ian Morrison if Jodrell Bank tracked any Apollo spacecraft. Ian replied that they used their 50-footer to track them all. Obviously, without pointing data, they did not track the spacecraft to or from the moon. But, as with Luna 15, once the spacecraft was near the moon, they could easily track, follow, listen in, eavesdrop, pick one, on Apollo's transmissions. Pritchard also said that they picked up the signals from the moon at 2300 MHz. As we've learned, the command module and the lunar module both transmitted in the range of frequencies implied by Pritchard's statement. That makes Pritchard's statement completely consistent with the facts. Jarrah is the only person who doesn't see it that way. So, the only way Jarrah can seemingly discredit Jodrell Bank as an independent verification of the lunar landings is to call both Ian Morrison and Bob Pritchard liars. Saying that Bob Pritchard changed his story, that Jodrell Bank couldn't track Apollo 11 and Luna 15 at the same time, or that they had their 50-footer tuned to the wrong frequency, is more than just ignoring the facts. It's more than a fallacy of omission. It's an attempt to make a mockery of the fine people who manage and operate the Jodrell Bank Observatory, past and present. It's just plain wrong. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators, wherever you are.